Thank you for watching this video from KingswaySoft. Today, I will be introducing the SSIS Integration Toolkit for Microsoft SharePoint. The SSIS Integration Toolkit for Microsoft SharePoint is a cost-effective, easy-to-use, and high-performance data integration solution. It utilizes Microsoft SQL Server Integration Services, SSIS, capabilities. This adapter will handle all the necessary intricacies when working with SharePoint web service interfaces. In today's demo, we will show you our software running in a SQL Server 2012 environment. If you are using a different SQL Server version, the interface will be slightly different. To get started, let's create a simple SSIS project. This tutorial will already assume that you have the SSIS bits installed, otherwise you will not see the SSIS project type here. In the Business Intelligence template, select the Integration Services project and give your project a name. Press OK to create the solution. SSIS is a platform that can be used to implement data migration and application integration using drag-and-drop features. To begin the SSIS implementation using our toolkit, we will configure the Connection Manager to manage the connections with Microsoft SharePoint Web Services. Let's start by right-clicking the Connection Manager area and select the New Connection option. Select SharePoint and press Add. If you do not see this option, go back and make sure that our software is properly installed on your machine. We are now prompted to enter the connection information to the SharePoint server. The first option you will notice in the interface is the authentication type. The authentication type will depend on how your SharePoint server is deployed. I will choose Active Directory for today's demonstration. The following option allows you to specify the SharePoint server URL. You can provide an alternative SharePoint web server URL, which will depend on your SharePoint setup. The Home Realm URI is where you can specify the URI of the cross-realm SDS service endpoint. It should typically be a URL starting with HTTPS. This option applies to the Federation and Online Federation authentication types and may only be required for certain federated environments. It's important to note that the Home Realm URI option is case sensitive. You can now fill in your login credentials in the authentication section of the form. Notice the Use Integrated Authentication option. You may use this option when the Active Directory on-premise authentication type is selected. The Username, Password, and Domain option allows you to specify the user account that you want to use to connect to your SharePoint server. The user account would need proper privileges in SharePoint. There is a timeout setting where you may adjust the timeout value in seconds for the connection. This allows you to specify a maximum number of seconds that the SharePoint Connection Manager will wait while trying to establish a connection with SharePoint. It is defaulted to 120 seconds. Note that in the advanced settings, there are some optional settings. The Retry and Intermittent Errors option is intended to help recover from possible intermittent outages or disruption of service so that the integration does not have to be stopped due to temporary networking issues. We have designed this option so that it should only retry when it's deemed to be safe to do so, but there may be exceptions. The Multi-Authentication Site option should be enabled if it is a multi-authentication SharePoint site. We also have an option to ignore certificate errors in case your SharePoint server is using a temporary SSL certificate. The next part of the form is an optional proxy server setting in the case where a proxy may be required. Before we hit OK, we should test the connection to make sure our information is correct and we can connect successfully. This connection manager will be used for our source component, so we will rename it accordingly. We're going to repeat this process to create a second connection manager to be used as our destination component. This connection manager will target a different service URL. After creating the SharePoint connection manager, you can start to create the data flow task to facilitate data integration. Within the data flow task, we offer two data flow components that would help you to implement integration solutions for SharePoint. The first component we'll discuss is the SharePoint source component, which is what you use to read data from the SharePoint server. Later on in this demo, we will show you the destination component, which is what you may use to write data into SharePoint. If you are using SSIS 2012 or later, you should automatically see these data flow components in the toolbox of the data flow view. If you do not see any components, you can click the SSIS toolbox button. Note that if you are using SSIS 2008 R2 or earlier, you would need to manually add these components to the SSIS data flow toolbox. In our example today, we will migrate documents from our SharePoint source to SharePoint target, along with the linked items relationships. We will also be leveraging the text lookup capability. Let's start with the SharePoint source. First, we'll drag the SharePoint source component to the surface of the data flow. Double-click the SharePoint source component to bring up its editor form. Here, we will start by selecting the connection manager named Source. The source list displays all SharePoint lists. Note that there is an option to show hidden source list. There is also an optional source view here if you have customized views. The batch size option allows us to specify how many records we want to retrieve each time. The default value is 500. We have some other optional settings next. The retrieve first page option can be used to limit the number of records to return when reading from SharePoint. When this option is enabled, the number specified in the batch size would be used as the limit parameter. There is also a variety of options in the document scope dropdown, which allows you to specify how you would like to retrieve your items. The default option is set to recursive files only, which will retrieve all files, including files within folders. The root level files only option retrieves all files within the root folder. This will not include files within folders. The root level files and folders option will retrieve every item on the root level, while the recursive all files and folders option will retrieve the entire document library. The Include Hidden Fields option allows you to specify whether the hidden fields are read and returned. By default, SharePoint returns ID prefixes for a number of fields, such as lookup fields. These IDs may not have any business value for the other side of the integration. By enabling the Remove ID Prefixes option, you can choose to remove them from the returned values. You may enter a Camel query to filter records according to your requirements. Our software includes a Camel Query Builder tool that helps you create or edit Camel queries in a visual fashion. When clicking the Launch Query Designer button, a designer window will appear. There is also a section for additional query options where it provides the capability to add custom XML nodes for some special query requirements, such as querying subfolders in the list. We will now go to the Columns page where you can specify what fields to read data from. By default, all the fields are selected. The best practice would be to only select the fields that you need to use in the downstream components. The Attachment Settings page gives the option to enable downloading of attachments and documents. When selected, there are two options for the download destination. The first option is to save to file system, where the attachments from your SharePoint source list will be downloaded to a file system folder. You'll need to specify the location to store your files. You can also select a value for prefix file name with column data, where data would be prepended as a prefix of file names. SharePoint list items can contain multiple attachments. The max files per list item setting can be used to specify the maximum number of files to download for each list item. The second option is to write to output data column, where the attachments from your SharePoint source list will be inserted into a data column in the SSIS output buffer. The column name prefix will be enabled, and you may specify a prefix for the SSIS output buffer. Notice that we have a refresh component button, which you can click to refresh the component to the latest SharePoint metadata. This is especially useful in cases where we have created or modified any fields in the SharePoint application for the specified list or document library, which would otherwise require deleting and recreating the component to reflect the mapping on the columns page. Let's click the OK button to finish the configuration of this source component. After configuring the source component, the next thing we will do is create a SharePoint destination component to write data to SharePoint. In our case, we are showing a SharePoint to SharePoint integration, which may not be the case in how you use our software. It could be SharePoint as the source, but another system as your integration destination, or the other way around. To illustrate the purpose of the destination component, we will drag this target component from the toolbox and connect to the upstream pipeline component. Note that in order to use the text lookup feature when writing to a document library, we will need to have two SharePoint destination components. The first destination is used to upload the files, whereas the second destination is used to update the lookup field of the newly created records. The reason for this is the limitation of SharePoint web services, because the lookup type field does not work under the web service method we use for the create action. We'll begin with the first destination to upload files. Let's select the connection manager named target. Once again, there is a show hidden option where we can view all lists, including hidden ones. You can see that there are 7 action types that can be performed when writing data to the Microsoft SharePoint server. The first 3 actions are create, update, and delete, where the primary key will be required when performing the update or delete action. The next action is create folder, which will allow you to create a folder structure without writing any list items or documents. Since our version 4.5 release, the check-in and check-out actions are available, whereupon we can specify if we'd like to check-in records or check-out records in SharePoint. Since our version 6.0 release, we've also added the moderate action, where we can perform content approval in SharePoint. For our purposes today, we will select the create action in order to upload a new document. There is also a batch size option in the destination component, where the default is 200. We have added support for the multi-threading feature, which allows you to perform multi-threaded writing, which can significantly improve the performance when writing data to Microsoft SharePoint. To configure the multi-threading feature, you can check the Enable Multi-Threaded Writing option. The default number is 16. This option supports a maximum number of 100 threads. There is a number of attachment columns options for list, where you can specify the maximum number of attachments per list item to write. SSIS input columns will be created based on the number that you have specified. Each attachment column will be named attachment number. There will also be an additional column named attachment number file name, which will be created to let you specify the file name of the file that you want to upload. We also have an optional setting where you can choose to remove invalid characters. This will remove any invalid characters from the input. When this option is enabled, it can avoid an XML exception when the component tries to construct the SOAP request to be sent to SharePoint. Similar to the source component, the destination component also has a refresh component button where you can click to refresh the component to the latest SharePoint metadata. In the columns page, you can map the columns from the upstream source system to the SharePoint destination fields. Automatic mapping will be done if there is a name match between the input column and the SharePoint field. Take note of the virtual underscore local relative path field. By default, if left unmapped, the virtual path will point to the root level of the destination list. If mapped, you can point to a different folder level within the list or document specified. We will show you the error handling page shortly when we configure our second SharePoint destination component. As mentioned before, there must be a second SharePoint destination component for text lookup demonstration. The second destination component will update the lookup field of the newly created records from the first destination component. The reason for this is due to the limitation of the SharePoint web services, in which the lookup type field does not work under the web service method used for the create action in the first destination component. In this case, we will select the update action. Navigating to the Columns page, we will now demonstrate the Text Lookup feature. The Text Lookup feature allows you to pass in text values to any lookup field. The component will do the lookup for you by finding the lookup record's ID value. You would map the input column containing the text value to the lookup field and press this button. Let's configure the lookup on the title field for the item field as our target. We can also choose an optional default value when there is no match found. When a default value is entered, it will default to this particular user when the lookup of the input value fails. In the advanced option, there is ignore case and report error on duplicates. The report error on duplicates option will report an error when a duplicate is found within a text lookup cache. If this option is off, duplicates are allowed, in which case the last matching records ID will be used. The text lookup feature involves populating an internal cache. There is a cache mode option that allows you to choose full or partial cache. Full cache is recommended when the number of records in the lookup list is small, while partial cache is recommended in the case where you are processing a small number of records, but your lookup list contains a large number of records. The last page is the error handling page, where there are three error handling mechanisms to choose from. The default option is fail on error, where the entire data flow will fail as soon as an error occurs. There is also the redirect rows to error output, where the error output will contain the failed records with extra columns, error code, error column, and SP error message. The ignore error option is generally not recommended, as the components will remain silent for any errors that have occurred. There is also the Enable Columns for Default Output section, which you can use to enable or disable the additional columns in the Destination component's default output. SharePoint ID gives you the newly created SharePoint Records ID. We have now established our data flow. We can execute this data flow task. This concludes a demonstration of our SSIS Integration Toolkit for SharePoint components. Thank you for watching this video. For any further assistance, please feel free to contact us.